All right, welcome everyone to KaiTalks 4.0, where we'll be focusing on job opportunities. Today with us, we have our two presenters, Shinar Torikan and Sayara Hussein-Nova. I hope I pronounced that correctly.
Yes,
correct. So how we'll run this meeting is we'll have Shinar present first, we'll have our Q&A for her, then we'll have Sayara present, and then we'll have Q&A for her. If you have any questions, we'll put up a Slido link soon, and just follow the instructions there, and it should be all good. So with that, Shinar, you have the stage. You can begin your presentation.
Hello, let me share my screen. Everyone can hear me well, right?
Yep.
And let's start. Let me know if you don't see my screen or slides are not changing. I will not be presenting in a like presenter mode because I previously had problems with that. And hello. So thank you for having me today. And like I was thinking for so long, like what could I present about? Like to be helpful to Kai's community. And the topic I came up with was like, what if I had like a time machine, what would I tell myself when I was a freshman? So this presentation will be around the topic, advice for like starting from freshman, they will go further to like some sophomore and other advices. Before we start, I wanted to start that I do not represent my employer, and all my opinions expressed here are of my own. And also, like the advice I'm sharing is what worked for me. So it might not work for you. So just like make a judgment call and decide if this will suit you. And also like check the policies and regulations because they might be already outdated. So let's start this introduction. So my name is Shinar. I got admitted to KAIST in September 2016 and graduated in August 2020. My major is advanced major with semi-minor in artificial intelligence. I graduated cum laude, like in the top of the class. I don't remember exact ranking, but if I like remember, it was like in the top 10 of like CS department. And currently I am SD at Amazon in London. As you can see, it's like morning here. And so you might already have questions like, where do I get my ranking? And what does cum laude mean? So basically I knew this information after I graduated. So maybe if you know it earlier, that would be helpful. So after graduating, you could send email and request your ranking, like let's say in case if you want to put that into the CV. And depending on the GPA, rating honors are indicated in the diploma. So like you could see ranges for different titles, like let's move on. So now you might have question like, does GPA matter? I would say it depends. In case of, for academy, I would say it's better to consult previous KaiTalks. And in case of industry, my personal opinion is that GPA is not that important. More important are your skills, your knowledge. And I would say there are two extremes of this. One extreme is that thinking like, oh, GPA doesn't matter and like not work on GPA, but also don't do anything on the side. I would say maybe having not good GPA is okay because you like contributed your time to something else, like making research in the lab or working on a side project. And then there is so kind of, this shouldn't be an excuse, like just doing like nothing on the side and just like not striving for a good GPA, in my opinion. But of course, like it's your decision finally, and you know what works best for you. And the other extreme is like prioritizing GPA over everything, spending all your time on high GPA. I also don't think that's very productive, because there are other important things except GPA. Maybe like you want like intern in the lab, or maybe you want to work on your side project, or maybe go out with your friends. So I would say don't spend all of your time on like prioritizing for high GPA. And then next thing is, you might ask why advanced major and how did you select your major subtype? So basically how I proceeded was by the elimination. So I would start with double major. At the time I wanted to graduate in 8 semesters, and I was like, double major would be too high load for me. Then like to graduate in 8 semesters. And then for major and minor, I considered other departments, which I could take as minor, which would help me like to be a stronger professional. And I selected a certain department and started to look into minor requirements. Like I wanted to take the department because I liked certain courses which I wanted to take. But when I see the minor requirements, this required to take some courses which I didn't think was helpful for me. So I decided not to proceed with that option. And then I looked into advanced major, and at that moment, when I looked into a courses list and looked on how many courses I need to take to satisfy graduation requirements, I didn't find enough courses which found like met my interest. And at that time, I proceeded with individual design major, because this offered like a freedom of selecting courses across various departments. And then like as time went by second and the third year, like each semester I tried to take course from another department. And once I attended that course, I could feel like that's actually not really what I want to learn, and kind of dropped the course after like first like trial class. And I started to think maybe I should reconsider something, maybe I need to, maybe select another option. And I started my look again. I looked into advanced major and looked in the list of courses offered. And I'm not sure what happened. Maybe CS department expanded, but there were so many courses which were so interesting for me that even if I satisfy all graduation requirements, there will be still some courses which I want to take. So I proceeded with advanced major. I would say that's great that KaiTalks offers this flexibility that you could even change your major, you could change your type of major, that there is such a flexibility. Of course, there is some like cutoff after which you cannot do that, but I found that this policy was quite like flexible. And for the next, it's like I get questions on a selection of career path in CS, like, and I understand this concern, like CS is such a big field with lots of specializations. So like, if you know what you want to do, then just like go ahead and plan for courses, take advice from people who are already pursuing that path. And for example, my friend like wrote a great guide on like if you want to pursue data science path in KaiTalks, like he wrote basically which courses you need to take in which order and from which departments. So if you could find it, that's great. And in my case, I didn't know which one to select. Like everything seemed like lots of career options seemed so interesting for me. So what I did, I was like search on the internet and take list of all the like options available, and then I would go through them and list down the ones which seemed interesting to me, and then I would make research on what was important for me, like what kind of projects they handle in a real life, regular day look like, what is like work-life balance. If you are concerned about job opportunities and like compensations, you can like go for job postings, like forums. And this is great, there are like so many videos which like take you and show the day of like certain career path. Also, you could find someone who's already in that path and like ask some advice, ask questions which bother you. And then once I narrowed down to some like explorable set of paths, I started my explorations via like internships or taking courses or making side projects to try like some new field and see what works for me, what is interesting for me. So maybe you can try the same approach. So the next thing would be, I would say when I was junior or senior, I would always like get this question like, oh, which course should I take next and et cetera. So my advice would be like, and next slides will be about that. So read bulletin early on. It lists graduation requirements so that you know what you need to take, and also make sure it's for your year, and read it very attentively. Like there are caveats, like special topics, courses limit. And I know that like due to such small things, some people were not able to graduate and had to take like extra semester to satisfy just like one course requirement. So read it very attentively. Next is about running graduation simulations. Like every semester I would run a graduation simulation. I couldn't find the exact link, but I think through main portal you can find it. Basically it evaluates which kind of requirements you need to take to graduate and kind of shows exactly whether your courses you take in matches criteria. And if I see that some course that didn't go in the category I expected, I would email like CS department and ask like, is this some like error or like what happened? Did I take wrong course? And usually after that, the report would be corrected. Like in my case, this was just like system error. Then I would say like plan ahead. There are cases like when people say, oh, operating system is requirement, but then let's say prerequisite wasn't taken and you need to postpone that course. And that's why for the course you want to take, plan ahead. It could be like sometimes like 3 or 2 semesters in advance to satisfy all these like prerequisites. And when I studied, I don't remember exactly, was it spring or fall, but I noticed that in the spring, there are more major required courses and less major elective, and in the fall there would be also major required but much more major elective. And what I would do is take more major required in the spring and more major elective in the fall. So because like I saw situations when like all major required are closed, but then in that particular semester there are not lots of like major elective courses to select from. And then read course reviews. In the OTL you can find them. You can ask from your friends who took this course to kind of see what it will look like and whether that's what you want. And on taking courses in breadth versus depth, I would say if you know exactly which career path you want to pursue, then pursuing like finding like courses in your topic and studying like in depth could be a great option. Like this means that after graduation you are really specialized in that domain. But if you're not really sure which option to pursue, I would say taking courses in breadth is also okay. That's what happened in my case because I was so interested in various courses that I would take so many different courses, like from like multi-objective optimization courses to like computer networks, computer vision, like automated testing, like lots of different types of courses. And I would say I don't regret it. I think it was very useful because I could see how different problems are approached differently in different fields. And when I need to design some solutions, I could come with some creative solutions because I have knowledge from various domains. So yeah, I think taking in a breath is also okay. And then on taking courses starting with code 4 and 5, I was like scared to take them early. I thought, oh, what if they're too difficult? Is it okay to take now? Am I ready to take it? And after taking them, I would say, I wish I could took them earlier because some of them are not like, how could I say, they are beginner friendly. It's not like you need some, like a lot of knowledge in the domain to be able to take that course. But of course, like first, like consult reviews, see your friends or drop email to professor, like explaining your level of knowledge and with their, like you could take this course. And then on taking prerequisites, I would say sometimes I will postpone course because I needed to take prerequisite. But after I took that course, of course, after meeting the prerequisite, I would think actually the prerequisite wasn't that mandatory in the sense that I could learn that material in a week. That's why if you see prerequisite and you think about postponing course, I would say again, like consult people who took this course and whether this requirement is actually like must have, or you could like quickly gain like needed knowledge during the semester. And about course taking strategy and paths, I would say in average, like I graduated in 8 semesters. And so in average, I had to take about 18 credits per semester. It's about 4 to 5 major courses in average. And on top of that, I would take some humanity, like one humanity course and some like sports course. And what my path was that in my first year, I like closed all my general required courses like physics, biology and other subjects. And then I closed major required courses first, like I prioritized closing them first because I was like worried, what if later, if I postpone it, what if I could not get a spot in the class and whether this could affect my graduation plans. And after that, I would take major electives. I would say when I look back on it, there are pros and cons. Pros, I would say that requirements are satisfied step by step and kind of it was easier for me like, to track my progress for this graduation requirement. And then, but the cons was that at the time I wanted to apply for internships, I didn't have projects which I wanted to put in the CV because like for major required courses, the project's very interesting, but in my opinion, they were not suitable for CV. And actually like interesting projects, they appeared in the third or fourth year. So that's why I had to make some like side projects which I could put into my CV. And then other path I saw, I think it was like quite interesting strategy. So let me share. So basically it's about taking general required and also basic major required courses in the first year, like discrete math, algorithms, data structures. In this sense, this like unblocks you to taking other courses earlier. And then you could start taking like major required mixing with the major electives so that you could get some projects you could put into the CV. So the pros of this are, as I mentioned, it's like you get unblocked because you took this prerequisites earlier and you could take like interesting projects earlier. But the cons of this, what I observed was like some people lose the interest in the basic, like in the general required courses in the final years. Like even you have interesting major courses and then like, let's say you need to close this basic required course this might be not that interesting, you might be not that motivated. And also people found the schedule not very convenient, like going at 9 a.m. at the class, going to mandatory recitation in the evening, or going to the quiz on Friday morning. So yeah, just like consider these things when planning your like courses. And then another advice, I would advise to go to the claim session. Of course, this could be time consuming, but why there could be grading mistakes. Like for example, because the problems are written in a not in order, this might be that the grader, for example, TA, just like missed the problem and didn't see it. Or for example, for certain statement, you get points. And this statement, for example, could be like simply missed during the grading. So I would say going there could be beneficial because you could get some points. And then it also helps to understanding grading policy, like what is the approach for that course to grade the exams. If I see that majority of the problems are like all or nothing type of grading, next time I take exam and I have some spare time in the end, I will not attempt like next problem. I would probably go through all my previous problems and make sure that I didn't make any mistake, because that could be all or nothing type of problem. So basically this helps you to understand grading policy and to calibrate your approach. And then when claiming, like use evidence like grading criteria, textbook, lecture slides. And also this could be that you, like I saw cases when student was able to prove that a solution like wasn't correct, and then all the exams for all students were graded with new grading criteria. So who knows, maybe you will be that student who will prove that this solution is not correct or has like some mistake. So yes, and on the improving the results, I would say claim sessions are helpful, because sometimes I would go to claim session not just like for points, but to understand how I could improve. For example, let's say when in like humanity courses where I need to write an essay, like I would come to session to understand like how I could do better next time, how I could like enhance my writing skills, and etc. And then for internships, the questions I get is like, when I should start? Is it too early? Like, can I already start? So I would say, in my opinion, even starting after freshman year is okay, because there some companies have special internship types focused on specifically like early, like university years, in which you cannot get when you are junior or senior. So I would say applying early is also great, like after freshman year. And next question I get is like, how to find them? I found the following cases helpful, like job fairs. In the KAIS, like in the sports complex, there will be regularly job fairs. And also in the COEX, there would be like job fair, like big job fair for international students. And it's also great, lots of companies hiring, looking for specifically international students. And then this KAIS career website, I wish I knew about this early, but I knew about this like too late, but I hope this information will be helpful. So there is a KAIS careers website where you need to log in with your like portal credentials, and basically you could see job postings from the companies. It's like a job fair, but going all year. And then next thing is KAIS, yes, Facebook group, also really helpful group where alumni share resources. And then also if you're interested in certain companies, it's going to their career websites, like putting notification, because some companies hire on like rolling basis, and roles could fill up like very fast. So I would say apply as soon as possible, just like my advice. And then I would say interviewing is a two-side conversation. So ask question from the company or from the team, like which bothers you, which will affect your happiness or productivity. Like, for example, will I be able to make great impact in this company? Like, will I be like able to grow professionally? Like, whatever is important for you, like, don't be afraid to ask. And then about, maybe you don't know, but, or maybe you know about this, but you could use internship to satisfy like thesis requirements or like as additional credits. As you know, like, let's say you need to close 140 credits, and when you divide them into different credit category, there is some amount of credits left, which could be from any category. So you could use internship also to close those additional credits. But the cases I also saw was that someone could write me and say, oh, like, I just finished my internship. Could you please explain how I can like use it as a like such thesis requirement? And I would say, oh, actually, like, you needed to apply before your internship started. So plan ahead, look for announcements, or go to the department and ask about timeline, so the application starts before your actual internship starts. And then, as you might know, in the end, you need to write a report. I don't remember exactly, was it like 20 pages? And I would say writing it in one sitting could be hard. So I would advise writing it frequently, like let's say every week or like every day. And then another thing is when interning, also consider labs. KAIST has great labs with like interesting research projects, like great professors, and some of them are like one of the most like leading and strong labs in the like world or in the industry. So I would say it's a great opportunity if certain lab is interesting for you. Maybe you might consider interning there and like gain some knowledge. And then another questions I get was like, am I ready? Should I apply? What if I get rejected? I would say I also had these concerns, and the technique which helped me was this technique. Basically, I would compare outcomes with the risk. So let's say in case of applying to internship, okay, in a successful result, I get offer and get my like internship of the dream. And in the worst case, like I get rejected, I like spend my time on interviewing process. I would say outcomes are much like, how could I say? No, the risks are not that big compared to outcomes. And secondly, even in this like worst case scenario, I still would be able to gain interviewing experience. This means that next time I will be less nervous and etc. So my decision in that case would be go for it. So maybe you could use same technique when you have similar situation. And then these are like random tips in from different categories which I wish like I knew maybe. So at some point I received advice like on taking some like easy courses, meaning like with low load, you get a high grade. And I tried one course, and I would say my experience after this was, I wasn't really satisfied. Yes, I was like low load, I was able to get high grade. But then in terms of knowledge, I would say I wasn't really satisfied. That's why I didn't follow that strategy. Let's say I would look into the sections and would usually prefer more challenging sections, or take the like courses which some people would avoid, but I would take it on purpose. And of course, at some point during semester, I could think, oh, like it's so hard. But then after I look back, I would say like, this was worth it. I gained like lots of great and deep knowledge. So of course it's like up to you, but I found like taking challenging courses more rewarding for me than like just closing easy credits. Then I would say about course load prioritization, because I took like 4 to 5 major courses and some other courses on top of it. I would say time was very scarce resource. And what I tried at first, I was like, I tried to do everything for 100%, and then like work a bit on this, work a bit on that, and work a bit on this. And then in the end, because I had like not enough time, it will be like not all of them will have 100%. And then later I was experimenting and got with a strategy which actually like was able to get me a higher grade. It's about prioritization. Let's say I have like certain tasks and I would go into a course syllabus and see what is the contribution. And I would calculate, okay, this task will contribute like 5% to my grade and this one will be 0.4%. Then I will prioritize making this task like 100% and then like take tasks in that order. And that in the end, when I see, I actually get like higher results. Of course, this could be beneficial if you are optimizing for grade, but if you are interested in certain project, of course, like go for it. Yeah, this is just strategy which worked for me. And another thing was about asking for signature beforehand. So what happened sometimes in my case was that I really wanted to take some course and I would say, and I would come in a like first lecture and professor would say, oh, like I already like gave signatures and I cannot take more students because this will affect like quality of course. And I would think like, how is it possible? Because like I was the first student in the line and basically the answer was about like sending email. So what I would do is that after lottery, if I see that demand is high and possibly not all the students could get the signatures and I really, really wanted to take that course and I was sure that I will not drop it, I would write an email to professor asking for a signature in advance. And then next thing is about past papers. Having past papers, knowing exam format really helped a lot in exam preparation. So if you could find that information, that's great. If there is no such information, I would say, don't be afraid to ask. I saw cases when let's say last lecture before exam, let's say one student asked like, professor, could you please share like past paper or like sample paper or explain the exam format? And I would say in some cases, professors helped with that. And I would say this was such a, it was very helpful for me because it made my test preparation easier, I would say, because I knew what type of problems could come and I could adjust my test preparation strategies accordingly. Next thing is about delaying topic exam. I would say don't delay it because I saw cases when people will postpone it on a last semester and let's say there will be just one point not enough to meet the graduation requirement, or let's say COVID started and all topics exams were cancelled and basically person had to wait till these exams are continued again to be able to graduate. So and other are the cases like you don't know what could happen, so if you can take topic early. And then another thing, like I didn't know about that, I knew about it too late, is that you actually could reimburse your topic exam, I think one time per year. So I think that's great. Like let's say if I took topic exam in my first semester and then I failed it, I could reimburse it and try like next year. Then about learning Korean, if you plan to stay in Korea, I would recommend to invest your time in actually learning Korean. Maybe like, let's say 10 minutes per day, but in the long run, this time will be accumulated and you will be able to gain that knowledge because this affects, like based on my conversations with my friends who like, let's say what they shared was learning Korean really improves the quality of life in the sense that imagine like you go into the shop and you could understand like everything, and that's great, right? Or let's say if you're looking for a job, some companies have requirement to be fluent in Korean. So if you are no Korean, you are expanding your job opportunities. So yes, if you plan to stay in Korea, I would recommend learning Korean. Like making effort to gain like deep knowledge. And then about traveling, like going out, I would recommend to spend the time on that, because in my case I would like always prioritize my studies or work, and I would say, oh, maybe thank you, like I will join you next time and things like that. My excuse was that, oh, like once I graduate I will have time, but COVID started, and then now I'm not in Korea, and I wish I explored Korea more. I was like going out more with a friend and like taking photos with my friends for memories, because like I hoped for a graduation ceremony to kind of take photos with my friends, but then like I didn't have graduation ceremony, so you don't know what could happen. So yes. And then about I think I made a typo here. Once you start interning, maybe you could get into that, being really motivated interning every holiday break. But then my advice would be, like what I did in my final semester, I kind of paused interning because my reasoning was that I think it's a great opportunity as a student that you have like 4 months in total per year for holiday. Spend this time to kind of to get a proper rest before stepping into the next step of my life. So I would say sometimes really like having holiday during winter and summer holidays is a great thing. And then finding mentors and building your community is important. I think I was really lucky to have such a great friends and mentors who would like support me along the way. So yeah, I think this is important. Another thing is study techniques. There's so many research results, so many books, and I would say it's worth to spend your time on researching on this, experimenting what works best for you. Because with this, I was able to get much more efficient, spend like less time and get a greater results just because I improved efficiency of my study techniques. And then another thing is KaiTalks library services are great. If you don't know about them, use them. Like I used a lot to order books and they would come and I could learn a lot. And then you also could renew like 5 times. So in total, like you could borrow a book for 10 weeks and it's like great. And then for scholarships, I would say apply for like scholarships which are posted inside of KaiTalks, and also look for them like let's say outside of KaiTalks. And kind of when I saw like scholarship opportunity, I was thinking like, oh, I would spend so much time for application, like time for application, and then the probability of getting it is so low. And I was like, okay, maybe I will just spend my time on like studying. But then I saw like lots of people actually getting that scholarship. So I would say sometimes getting scholarship is possible. There are like for some groups of people, there are some additional scholarships, for example, for women in like CS, there you could find some additional scholarships, funds make scholarships to which you could apply. Another thing is about conferences. For example, it's not like the conference where you present, but where you actually learn something. So I, for example, one of my friends was able to go to Singapore to attend conference and like gain some knowledge, and like whole trip was covered. And so there are like lots of opportunities like this. Another great opportunity, like I wish I knew earlier, but I knew about this too late. There is like Anita Borg scholarship. Basically, there is such a conference, which is like Grace Hopper conference each year. And I attended it this year, and I would say it's great, like so many knowledge. I met so many like people. And also if you're looking for a job, there is like also like a job fair going on. And if you like as a student, if you apply for that scholarship, you basically get your trip covered, your conference ticket covered. And this conference usually takes place in the US. So I would say this is a great opportunity to like travel and also gain knowledge and possibly even get a job offer out of the conference. Another thing is, I knew about this from my friends, so that in case if you don't know, KaiTalks has like a great like insurance. For example, you could reimburse like your NHI subscription fee, and also you could reimburse, let's say, your medicine you bought in the pharmacy, and then like let's say some accident happens on campus and like you need some like expensive surgery, this also could be covered by insurance. So I would say, yeah, that's it. Thank you for attention. Thank you for finding time to join this session. I know that finals are like coming, and like good luck with your finals. If you want to connect with me, you can find my profile in LinkedIn and Facebook. I would do my best to answer, but if I don't reply, please follow up. Yes, and please forgive me if I don't reply. Yes, thanks a lot for your attention. And if we have time for Q&A session, yeah, let's go for it. But like after I think about 10 or 15 minutes, I need to drop for next meeting. Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, Shinar, for the presentation. All right, before we move on to our next speaker, if you have any more questions for our speakers, then you can email them to Kisa and we'll forward them to the speakers and then get back to you guys. So now, Ciara, you have the stage.
Okay, hello everyone, can you hear me well? Okay, sure. So let's start. Just a second. Okay. So it's fine. Okay, so my name is Sayar Hussainova. I'm from Azerbaijan, and I would like to thank Anar who started this talk over. So I received my bachelor's diploma in KAIST. I did industrial and systems engineering as my major, and I decided to make a management of science. Can you see well? Okay. Yeah, and also I did my Techno MBA marketing in KAIST as well. I did it in KAIST College of Business, the second one. The first one was in the Dejan campus. Well, I have experience working in Korean company, Delim Industrial, one of the biggest construction companies in Korea. I also had a chance to work in Turkey, also it's a construction part. Now I'm in Azerbaijan, in my motherland, working for Estonian technology company, which is related with mobile signature, digital signature. we're a national mobile operator to Azerbaijan. National operator to Azerbaijan. So now I would like to talk about the question why I am now where I am. I work for Business Development Communication Department. Well, I believe there is a quite exclusiveness of digital marketing in the 21st century, and the field is going to innovate and innovates from the period of time. When you say about digital marketing, it's more likely about the content marketing, search engine optimization, the digital campaigns. So here the one may choose different perspectives like search engine marketing, social media marketing, affiliate marketing, or maybe influencer marketing, email marketing, and all other related spheres as they're growing up. Or it might be viral reality marketing, which is expanding this time of the year, and is going to be the trend for the next years. I chose this sphere because I realized how it's important because it allows the business to be to reach a specific audience with less sources, and with this one can analyze the effectiveness of marketing campaigns of social media post and understand if there is a change to some analysis. Why digital marketing is important? Why would we think of it in the perspective? Because, I started as an industrial engineer, and then I realized that after working in the industry that I don't really want to do this. And later I applied to KAIST with Techno MBA with marketing division, because marketing shows me how effective is this sphere, how interesting it is to me, because it can show perspective in a relatively short period of time. And I believe that the research shows that in small and medium businesses, marketing shows there are faster and better results than it does in the bigger ones, because there is no fresh start is always okay for small companies, but for big companies there should be like this trust thing has to go to understand. Also I want to say that like the coronavirus reality showed us not every profession survives through the coronavirus. Most people, I can see in my own country that they have to switch, or they have to be fired because there were not resources for that. And in case of digital marketing, it's more online handling the issue can be also fine, because digital marketers work with project managers and with designers these are two, three main people with whom they handle operations, or with product owners, to make sure that the product or the service is delivered well and the audience understands it well. That's why I believe that digital marketing is a trend for future, where there is a possibility of working from any point of the world, and no matter if you're online or offline. Of course, online loses its significance to offline, but given the reality, and you know that the new coronavirus is about to reach the world, and some of countries are already in the process of shutting down or already shut down. The Omicron is coming. So that's why seeing how much you can operate with data and do it that from the different, like more safe space is important. Mm-hmm. And I want to mention that the career is there is constantly expanding. So, and there is also the opportunity that if there is chances to impact not even small businesses, but also big businesses like B2B or B2G, the most important parts here are like getting for micro moment marketing to understanding of consumer behavior, to understand what the audience of the potential customer may want. To provide innovative content, it can be like post, it can be photo, animation, or video. Video is getting more popular these days, and not only because of this interactiveness, but also because of the fact that it's more easily reaching the customer, the potential customer. Digital marketing is the tool which eliminates and breaks down the barrier between customer and seller. Yeah, because digital marketing, in fact, what I can see in practice is more about informing about the company or service or product, and then providing education how to use the service and why the service can be important. So it's very, so how marketing helps and in the industry shows that it's very hard to it's very hard to follow the business without knowing the potential customer, the analysis of the market. The reason why I chose this sphere is because I believe that I more or less possess with four qualities for this area. So, and what I would like to suggest to our speakers, our graduates, that for most and foremost is that don't forget to be yourself, and don't change your mind just for sake of an audience. And it's important to provide the, a fresh view of what you're doing, because most of the companies forget that people on social media not only search for current product, current product or service, but they also want to have this like bonding, have this like entertainment they spending time. So being funny, being easy, and being open to innovations is important. Also, it's also very important to be creative to what you believe you can do, because the digital marketing sphere is changing very fast, and what is important today might not be important tomorrow, and it's very important, it's very significant to keep up with the trends, with all potential views of providing the information to reach every potential customer or like the person you really want to deliver the business, deliver the product. And I believe as in every business, it's very important to be adapted. Like you have to understand the fundamentals of the business. Of course, it's not very important. It's not easy to do it in the very beginning, but as more as you're digging into the sphere, you need to understand what is this fundamentals and what is the core part of the business which really makes effect to the business. Also, I would like to provide statistics of digital marketing. Digital marketing statistics and trends. I will start with trends. First of all, I would like to say that the digital marketing statistics in business shows that how measurable and adaptable it can be. And it's easy to customize efforts and see, you know, if one campaign goes well, you can see that in the very first day or maybe 2 days maximum, but later, if it doesn't work well, it's easy to interrupt the business and change the mode. Regarding the statistics, I would like to say that almost all online transactions, like 93% of them, start with search engine. So it means that if one has very good business on its social, on the websites or social media, so the possibility that user will, the potential customer will find his or her business and get the product is very huge, because like SEO practices are made formalizing the core part of the digital marketing. And through all the statistics, I want to mention that like 86% of marketers increase brand awareness with digital marketing channels. So knowing that almost everyone like spending most of this, like at least 2-3 hours per day with social media or with websites. So it's very easy to integrate to my, in a proper way to provide information about the business. And I want to inform you that like more than 80% of marketers increase their social media activity after the coronavirus pandemic started. And most of the paid advertisement in 2002 is going to seen in the fact that now more than like normally a person can see more than 3,000 ads per day. Like it's not necessarily seeing up the screen. It can be provided from the third party cookies, from just like banners you see from the street. And the digital advertisement spending now is the most value-added part, as it's about to reach around 500 billion in this year. Regarding the salaries of digital marketing managers, I want to say that, so if you're planning to stay in Korea, you're doing a great job for digital marketing, because Korean Asia is earning more in digital marketing sphere than other countries around. The best country for digital marketing is Japan. It's around $800,000 in average. And so for those who are starting the sphere in this, or starting the career in this sphere, might see that the numbers are like, even with less than 1 year experience, is around $35,000. Like early career is around $45,000, and so on. And also, I would like to mention that the significance of it, this sphere shows that if not correct person or employee is chosen for the company, like more than around $400,000 is about to lose every 1 year well, for small and medium enterprise, and relatively more will be spent for bigger companies who are about to launch the product or service, but they not do it by integration of digital marketing. And the countries in paying quite good amount of money in the world, there can be Australia, New Zealand, USA, Canada, and other countries. I would like to talk a little bit more about what matters in CV and recommendations for getting in, mostly for graduate series in KAIST. When I graduated from KAIST, Daejeon campus, so I did my bachelor's. Of course, I, as other students, I wanted to follow my career, and I thought for the some period of time that doing master's in KAIST will be the best decision. And I applied to KAIST, and I was so highly motivated to stay in KAIST so that I didn't really apply to other universities, so only with one other in Korea. So when I get the refusal from KAIST, I was very upset, and I was thinking that what I can do for that time. And also, well, a parallel with that, like, I applied to two universities, and then I decided, so in case if KAIST won't, if things don't go well, I might go to the industry. And I applied to Daejeon Industrial and the other three, four companies in Korea. And even though, like, I was approved from other university with full scholarship, and by the way, I would like to mention that I received full scholarship from KAIST, master, bachelor's and master's both. Even though I was I received the invitation from another university, I realized that maybe that was the time for me to learn more about the industry itself. So what I learned in school was some knowledge, but maybe industry will show something different. So working 1 year in Daejeon Industrial showed me actually that that was not really what I wanted to do in my life. And within the like 6 months of working there, I realized that the minor degree which I received in KAIST Management of Science provided me the understanding of management and more or less of marketing. So I thought about switching the, like, slightly changing my profession career to marketing strategy management. And by that time, I applied to KAIST and to Manchester. I was received, luckily I was received by both of them, but I preferred KAIST because I believe that KAIST would provide more information and will be more relative to me because of the curriculum I went through, and my friends who were in KAIST Seoul campus, they share with insights of the school, and I believe that that was the place. Relating, so you might say that it's quite a journey because I was not accepted after doing my bachelor's, but right 1 year after I did, I worked in Daejeon Industrial. In the company, I was accepted, and more than that, I was accepted with full scholarship program. The reason is that I guess I could have provided good experience that I was able to go through, and know what I can do in KAIST would help me to do my following steps. So my advice here would be, well, of course, everyone's path is different, but if there is a chance, not go to master's right after graduating, because sometimes what we learn, it's a little bit different from what we seeing the practice. So if there is a possibility, try to get more practice, and then to see if this is possible to go to this master's. And the reason why I was chosen, because I believe, is because of the experience of in top Korean company, industrial company. And even though my GPA, which was relatively less than other candidates, but the cover letter in which I provided my real passion to the university, to studying in this university, and to see how I can deepen my understanding of marketing, and the way how can I involve other professionals in my business, and how can I share knowledge with them, maybe made a strong impact, and that's why I was chosen. Also, I want to say that, like, as my experience shows, don't try to put everything in your CV. Like, if you go to, if you have your diplomas from English writing essay sessions or communication clubs, it's not really important to mention all of them in a very detailed. It's important from when I was forming my CV, I got advice. So from my advisor and also from English grammar teacher professor who helped me to make things in the correct way. Also, I got advice from my friends about using right keywords, which are important during the screening CV screening procedure. Also, I suggest to provide information in a user-friendly way, because sometimes people just write information, but it's really hard to see what is what. But if you have some even small designing skills, so you can make it, or you can apply. There are a lot of online CV from creating websites. You may also get helpful from them. Also, the very important part, whether it's a job for a job or for graduating for the university, make sure that you have an impressive cover letter where you really, really show your strong passion to study or to work, and what you're going to do with this gained information or with the experience. It's very important to add real words, not just like copy them from the sources, but showing that this is what you want to do. In my case, relating the defining events and opportunities at KAIST were meeting sessions with professors, and we also had the business owners visiting KAIST for some conferences from Korean or overseas companies. So I did my very best to be there to see people.
Sarah, is everything good?
I'm sorry. Yeah, sorry, my battery was down. Now it's fine. Yeah, so I was saying that it's very important to keep up with the, like, all activity, not of course all, but some of the most prospective activities going in the campus. And there are a lot of difference in when I was in KAIST. I hope it proceeds now too, like leadership programs with advisors, breakfast sessions with advisors, visiting job fair conferences, even if you're only your second or third grade, or maybe the beginning of the fourth grade. I strongly suggest you to visit these conferences to see how things are going, whose leading skills are preferred by customer, by company owners, or from the who are really getting the by really getting recruited, and to understanding that, you can prepare yourself for industry. Yeah. And as Shinar mentioned earlier, I think that it's very important to make sure that having fun is also important, to value the time, because we all know that life is a challenge, and COVID time shows that sometimes it's really hard to make things work and travel and see, you know, beautiful places in Korea. But you have to also know that if you have this nonstop focus to study, to get a job, and you will only make yourself like too much worry. But if you enjoy life and try different kind of things, like opportunities, learning more about Korean culture, which is really great. And I believe that there is that enjoy, there is a will to learn and prosper. Well, I had a chance to join many different activities in the university, Tea House, and different other sessions which were organized during the time that I was in KaiST. And also, I strongly suggest that if there is a possibility for you to join even short program internships, do your very best, join them, like 2 weeks, 1 week, a couple of days, like you have your great summer, winter holidays. Of course, you have to rest, but if there is a chance to have small internship programs related with your with the industry you want to get in, try to use as much as you can, because sometimes what you study for turns out that it's not really what you want to do in your life, or it will help you more to understand your path to your path to successful career. And also, I would like to advise to search for professionals in the sphere that you want to dig in. Use LinkedIn, see what they have in their portfolio or in their LinkedIn profile, what they are capable of, what certificates they have passed. Also, I suggest you to exchange ideas with other graduates or those who are on their fourth or third year. Exchanging ideas to see what kind of possibilities are available now. KaiST provides very good information about like job opportunities or maybe what programs. So I think that make yourself some tradition that once in a week or maybe once in 10 days, you just scroll up and see what kind of activities or what kind of programs are now available in the university. Also, I would like you to see if there are possibilities for attending conferences. Offline is much better because you can see other people from the field and see what they are about, what's going in the industry, in the real world. Regarding the skills that I find the most beautiful, well, I think that communication skills is the most important, maybe in every sphere, more or less, because with communication skills, you you can see how to develop other skills, because you can get to the industry, you can get to work and talk with other people, learn more, learn information from them, and then develop your technical skills. And that's why like negotiation and collaboration skills in the team is important. Of course, like starting from the decision-making skills, now you're about to graduate, what are you going to do? What is your path, the following steps? It's important to see the picture. Like it's important to understand the values, what you really want to do, not only because it's like, say, it's the only chance right now, or you know, like the the sphere pays you more or pays you like right now you can get into the industry, but really understand if this is what you want to do. And of course, for later using the management skills, because today you might be employee, but after some time you might be employer. Don't forget about that. Don't forget about the opportunity that you're already selected, like you're studying in such a great university. So I think that all passes are open to you, but it's just important to choose the right direction. I tried to enjoy my life in KaiST as much as I could. I talked about, we have the UN program, and I introduced my country, Azerbaijan, in different schools, and also tried to support my friends in Korea who are now around the world. Some of them stay in Korea, some of them moved to the countries or other places. Before starting the small video, I want to say that maybe you remember there was a very, like maybe you, some of you might say early movie, but there are a couple of words that I want you to listen for. So let me start.
When we were five, they asked us what we wanted to be when we grew up. Our answers were things like astronaut, president, or in my case, the princess. When we were 10, they asked again. We answered rock star, cowboy, or in my case, gold medalist. But now that we've grown up, they want a serious answer. Well, how about this? Who the hell knows? This isn't the time to make hard and fast decisions. This is the time to make mistakes. Take the wrong train and get stuck somewhere. Fall in love. A lot. Major in philosophy because there's no way to make a career out of that. Change your mind and change it again because nothing's permanent. So make as many mistakes as you can. That way someday when they ask what we want to be, we won't have to guess. We'll know.
Yeah. This is pretty much what I wanted to talk. Thank you very much for your attention. And on the picture, there's my daughter. I hold this KaiST t-shirt, like which is, I guess, more than 10 years old. So I'm 12 years old. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your presentation, Sayara. Now we have some questions from the audience.
Okay, just a second.
All right, let me know when you're ready.
Okay, sure. Okay.
All right. First up is that given that KaiST is a science and technology focused university, do you think pursuing BTM is worth it?
Pursuing what? I couldn't
hear. Pursuing that. BTM as a major.
So you mean business development? Well, I can say that given that I worked in the industry, so my three of the places that I had a chance that I'm working, I was working, it gives me the idea of how the things work. And so now I work for mobile electronic signature provider. So, and this is important for me to understand the procedure. How it's created, how it's provided to people, what are the intrinsic part of it. That's why, so understanding the industry nature is important for me.
Mm-hmm. Our next
question. To provide the content for that. Yeah, okay.
All right, thank you. Our next question is, what's the difference between an engineering major and an MBA versus taking BTM and engineering double major in KaiST?
Well, because having a graduate series, I was able to see more of the industry perspective and how it is applied, like business cases of how like techno MBA, like technology sphere is changing in the world.
Mm-hmm.
But in minor, it was mostly about like the introduction of the sphere.
So which would you recommend to people? Would you recommend that they do an engineering bachelor's and then take MBA? Or would you recommend that they take a BTM and engineering double major?
Well, I think that it's it all depends on the case that one wants to, the path one wants to pursue. Because for me, there was like, I started with industrial systems engineering, but then I saw that there might be a gap because I had a couple of internship programs and I realized that industrial part is not the place where I want to go. So I could handle the management with me. So when I start to follow my path, having knowledge from management and having diploma from management will help me to pursue my career. So I guess like it all depends on like what you really want to do. So if you are so much sure that okay, I want to go with this this technical background, why not? But if you want to make yourself clear that okay, if something changed or if my mind changed, and I can also after seeing what management provides, you can follow that path too.
Mm-hmm.
Having your B plan, you can say.
All right. And I guess this would also be up to a person's taste, but which engineering combination do you think goes best with a BTM double major?
I think it's better since I have industry experience, like minor for me was fine. But if there is no opportunity for having a real experience in the company, so it's better to have double major. But if there is a understanding of things more or less in the practice, so I think having minor is enough.
Which engineering major would you recommend to double major with? So like mechanical engineering plus BTM or aerospace plus ETM. Which combination would be the best?
Well, I think that for every industry, that might work. So depending where you want to follow up with. So it can be if mechanical engineer, you can start with working things technical and see where you can do that in the industry. But if you want to go more than for the management, so you can juggle things up and see what you can see for this perspective, because you can even screen like professionals in this field and see where it comes to.
All right. And what are the various career prospects as a BTM major?
Well, I think that here it's very important to start with search engine optimization, search engine marketing and data analysis, marketing data analysis, which gives the ground understanding of working with data. So this is like cool parts. And this is where your technical part is important. And later it's more working with or being industrial design, industrial having it with mixing it with marketing, digital marketing, because mm-hmm. it's all more or less correlated with each other.
All right. Next is what you need to prepare for your job applications in business related roles.
Well, it's very important to know where you're going for interview. So coming with learning the website, the programs the company offers, like, and with ideas that, okay, for example, I learned about the strategy of your company. I believe that my opinion on what blah, blah, blah will help you. So coming with real examples is important. That makes you different from other candidates. But like coming to and answering questions that employer or recruitment agency gives you is not enough. Real and believing what you can do for the company without them asking you a question, saying that, okay, from this perspective, I can be helpful and I can understand this information and learn so on. It's also adds value in the program. And also, I want to mention that sometimes people add so much information in their CV that it's really hard to say, to focus on the most important part. So dig into the sphere and seeing what kind of keywords are important and then adding them to the to CV. Helps to increase the chance.
Mm-hmm. Now, as you know, a lot of students are worried about internships in KAIST. So mm-hmm. where do you look for internships in business for international students who are not fluent in Korean?
I did internship in Korea. I did also in manufacturing company. I tried to involve my Korean friends to help me with that. Also, I talked with advisors. And when I was back to Azerbaijan, I also tried to two or three internship. I was engaged in two or three internship programs. So I believe that it's more about communication. Mm-hmm. So if you have very good communication skills, if you reach more people during the conferences, during the some programs, it will help you. So you don't really just exchange visit cards, but you need to use them and understand how you can use this new connection. Not use, but like how can you get benefited from making a benefit from this connection, like in the business sphere.
Yeah, so networking is very important.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. And I guess the next one is, which area of BTM should a person focus on the most? Or would this again depend on your interests?
Well, it truly depends on interest, but like being adaptive, it starts with being adaptive because the fundamentals of the sphere have to be understood and perceived in a correct way. So handling with the techniques of digital marketing, like data analysis and CEO, understanding of CEO and how it works, how can it change from just like getting accustomed and paying actually for the service. This is the most important part, I believe, for the very start. And of course, there might be designing skills as well, like pretty much like Photoshop, Illustrator, to understand, and also knowing the trends of the future case, like the viral reality, how it affects now people, how it can be used in the planning of the advertising campaigns also have to be analyzed.
All right, that was our last question. Thank you for your presentation and your Q&A.
Thank you very much. It was very much fun. If you have any questions, you can reach me.
Yep. And as we said before, if you once you leave the meeting and you have any more questions, you can forward them to us. We'll forward them to the speakers and get back to you. I guess thank that's you. It. Yep. Thank you, everyone, for joining.
Goodbye.
Before I need to take a screenshot, Sayara. So can you, like, everyone, like, please smile?
Okay.
All right. All good. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Have a good day.
Bye-bye. Bye. Goodbye.